honestly, I think you're at the right place, all right? I think you're at the right place. I'm going to talk to you, and I don't know how much I'm going to be talking about this, maybe a couple weeks or 3 weeks, but it's one of my favorite subjects to talk about. I'm a pastor. When God called me to the ministry, I believe he not only called me to be a minister of the gospel, I believe that God called me into the pastoral ministry, and I thank him for that. And it's been an honor to serve him and his church. And I never, 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 never get tired of talking about the church. His church, big church, the universal church of Jesus Christ. So today we're going to do that. I'm just going to talk to you. This might be even maybe almost like a Bible study, okay? I don't care how it might appear. I just want the message to flow, and I want us to grab a hold of some things. And maybe for some, let me just preface it by saying this. Maybe for some of us, we have to maybe almost, Ms. Pimmer, almost, we might have to almost deprogram ourselves a little bit to reprogram, okay, what God wants to say to us. Sometimes we've got to deprogram ourselves. You know, you maybe have been used to doing something for so long and it works and you don't want to change, but somebody shows you a better way of doing it, and even though you know it's a better way, but still down somewhere deep in your heart, you don't want to change because you're stubborn or because you think your way has always been right, and because you don't like change, and because you get a bad attitude if somebody shows you something better. No, I'm just going on crazy here. Okay. But the whole point is, let's be open today to what God wants to say to us. The Church of Jesus Christ is absolutely amazing. It's more amazing than I can even express to you. It's more amazing than what I'm going to tell you. And it's more amazing than anybody can say within just a few short minutes. Some of the stuff I'm going to say might be, again, like I said, brand new, but that's okay. Just listen to it, absorb it, and look at some scriptures together, and let's just see what God has to say to us, okay? Okay. If you have your sermon section there, we've got just a few blanks to fill in, and then not very many, but on the very beginning, let's please establish this to start with. This is the definition I've heard several years ago, and I've heard it again over the last few days, a few weeks. So let's just embrace this, and I believe it's a good one, all right? I believe it's a good one. This is not original with me, but I like what it says, and I believe it to be totally true, okay? First of all, we understand that the church is not a place. We talked about that before, and I don't want to bore you with that, but we understand this is a church building, and even though we say we're going to church, we know what each other means when we say that. But we understand that the church is not a place that I go, nor is it an event. Hey, Chris, since you're there, can you pop up those middle lights just all the way up since you're right there? I wasn't going to say that, but since you're there, boom, you can do it. Thank you. All right. The church is not a place that I go to or an event that I attend, okay? We like to go to church functions or a church outing or into a church service, and we say that, and that's okay. That's okay. We understand that. But the true definition. But the church is this. The church is a spiritual family that I belong to. The church is a spiritual family that I belong to. If you are a part of a corporation and you go to work, but you can go to work in your car, you can go to work on a bus, you can go to work and go to a building, or you can go to work and go to a restaurant and do your work, but you tell others and you tell yourself, I'm going to go to work and I work for GE or GM or Ford or Chrysler or whoever, just keep naming your company. And so we know that there's a building that they operate out of, or several buildings, but you work for that company, and you are part of that company no matter where you are. Okay, so I just want to kind of get that for the basis. And then I also got some stats this last week that kind of blew my mind, but it's pretty amazing. Every Sunday in the United States, about 120 million people go, here I go again, go to church or go to a church building, or they sit in their homes and watch the church or whatever, okay? They go to a church worship service. That means that in America, more people go to church, to a church service on a single week, on a single weekend, than all that go to attend every professional sporting event for the entire year. That's pretty amazing. We see these arenas full of people, you know, where it be a football game or basketball game or baseball games or whatever. We see all these places that are, man, what do they hold? They hold 30,000, they hold 40,000, whatever. We could say, wow, that's crazy, that's amazing. But more people go to church on a weekend, one weekend, than all those sporting events for an entire year, okay? So the question I ask is why? Why does that take place? Now, behind the why, I'm aware of this. I'm aware there's a lot of different answers, okay? And if we would have a show of hands and really some good transparency this morning, but I'm not going to do that, okay? I mean, unless you want to. But, why do they do that? Why are all these people going to church? Why is it happening? And we think, well, you know, some of these churches, man, the buildings are closed, or man, there's only 15, 20 people in these little buildings. And I forget how many churches close every week in America. But, you know, some, it's almost like in our world, you know, the small get smaller and the big get bigger, that kind of thing. But why does this take place? Why do people do this? What are the benefits? What are the payoffs? Why get out of bed and go and attend a church service when you can stay at home? Why is all that going on? Okay. Now, obviously, let me just give you some of the answers, okay? Some people attend because they feel guilty. Okay? That would be one reason why people attend church. They feel guilty. Some people do it only out of duty. It's my duty. I need to do this. You know, it's just a pure duty thing. Some would do it because somebody pressured them to do it. Okay? Don't be raising your hand this morning, okay? But maybe somebody pressured them and they said, oh, okay, you know, you did me 3 favors, and you know, because of that, I told you I would go to church. So you kind of bargained with them, okay? So there's all kinds of some do it because of habit, and some do it because it's a tradition. Oh, I would never think about doing it. You know, my great-great-great-grandfather and mother attended church, and you know, my dad would roll over his grave if I didn't attend you. So, you know, it's a traditional thing that we're doing. So there's lots of different reasons as to why people attend church. Okay? Now I'm going to go ahead and say this. There's different reasons this morning as to why you're here. Okay? If I would go to each section this morning and just go one by one and write down all these things, there's different reasons why you're here. All right? And that's okay. That's okay. But I think the point that I want to make is this. I think we need a clear reason as to why church? Why there is the church of Jesus Christ? Why is it? Okay? And so I think as far as being a part of a church family, I think you need to give the reason. Somebody would ask me, well, why do you go to church? I think you need to give them not just a reason, I think you need to give them the right reason why you go to church, okay? And so we're going to talk a little bit about that, you know, the Church of Jesus Christ. And I've been thinking about this over the last couple of days. I thought, you know what, here I am. I pastored in, you know, 2 or 3 places in Ohio and in Indiana and Pennsylvania, and I'm back here in Ohio pastoring, and I think, wow, just what? It's not because I've been the pastor, but it's been called, I've been a part of about 5 different churches, and in being a part of those churches, I happen to have been the pastor. Now, prior to that, before I was in the pastorate, I attended church. Did that surprise you? You know? My daddy was a preacher, okay? And we had church at least 3 or 4 times a week, all right? We had two or three revivals a year that lasted anywhere between a week to 10, 15 days. And then we used to have those, remember those Sunday afternoon, remember you used to call them Song Fest? oh, boy, that's a, you know, or Singspiration. And, you know, we're gonna have church today, then we're going to have dinner on the ground, then we're going to come back at 2:30 and we're going to sing. And I always wondered, you know, man, oh, man, you go, you get all full, then you go back into church service and try to sing. I don't know why they did that. But anyway, so I'm, you know, way before I started pastoring, I went to church, all right? So in case that's what surprised you, I just kind of want to set that straight. But I'm thinking about all the things of my life that I associate with because of the church. It's crazy. I mean, it's absolutely amazing. And I'm talking about the church of Jesus Christ, not just a congregation, not just a Life Point Church in Plymouth, Ohio, or a Terre Haute Faith Church in Terre Haute or whatever. I'm talking about all the different churches because of the church world and because of God's church, how my life has been so blessed. I'm just going to give you a couple examples, all right? Obviously, if it wasn't for the church of Jesus Christ, I wouldn't be here today. Okay? And really, you wouldn't be either. I mean, I could put out a newsletter to all the zip codes around this area and say, hey, come over to Plymouth at 10:30. We're going to just get together, and I'm not sure what we're going to do, but would you please come? Would you please come? You guys would read that and say, well, what's going on? But there happened to be a church building here where we congregate together as God's people. This is our meeting place as we are the church where we meet here. So I got thinking, okay, so I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't know you folks, like, you know, I don't happen to have any immediate family here, so I wouldn't know any of you all without the church. You see what I'm saying? All my friendships. It's amazing. Kevin, I know you because of the church. It's not because you're a great guy. It's not because of Plymouth, Ohio. It's because of the church. And when I think about this, it really almost blows my mind. And then you drive someplace 100 or 200 or 2,000 miles away, and you meet again in another venue or a place with other Christ followers, which is the Church of Jesus Christ. And then I've got a bunch of more friends, and there's other relationships that take place. And it's all because of the church. Why is that? Why is that? It's because Jesus Christ, He died for the church. He shed His blood for His church. So I just want to give you a few things about the church before we go to the benefits that I want to talk to you about this morning. So why is the church the most important group on earth? And by the way, it is. The Church of Jesus Christ is the most important group on earth. And it's that because the church is God's family. Okay? It's God's family. I mean, you have your family, and I've got my family, and even sometimes we can maybe get together as two or three or four different families together. But they're still your family and my family. And if we went to a big hall somewhere where there's lots of tables, but we were all there from different families, can I give you a surprise? You'll probably sit with your family, and I'll probably sit with my family. But the church is God's family. It's God's family. In 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3 it says, God has given us the privilege of being born again so that we are members of God's own family. That's so powerful. I gotta keep moving, okay. The church is not only God's family, the church is the reason God created the universe. Because God wanted family. God wanted it. In Ephesians chapter 1, Paul said this to the church at Ephesus. He said, long ago, even before He made the worlds, even before He made the world, God chose us to be His very own through Christ and what He would do for us. So God wanted family, and that's the church. Okay? The church also is God's agent on earth for his purposes. And God has a lot of purposes. And he has a purpose for you and for me and for all of us and our families and our organizations and whatever else it might be. So it is God's agent on earth for exposing his purposes. Let me just give you another scripture on this one too. In Ephesians chapter 3, it said, God intended that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to all the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms according to his eternal purpose, which he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. So again, the powerful, powerful thought of the church. And like I said earlier, God died for the church. God died for the church. Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. He died so that he could give the church to himself. Like a bride in all her beauty, he died so that the church could be pure and without fault. Again, the church, what is it? The church is that spiritual family that we belong to. The church also exists because it's the only church that will, it's the only thing that will last forever. And only the church is the only thing that will last forever. Your business won't last forever. Your family won't last forever. You know, your money won't last forever. Well, that's a rude awakening, isn't it, huh? Remember trying to stretch those dollars? Okay. Only the church is going to be that which is going to last forever. Glory will belong to God and his church and in Christ Jesus for all time and for eternity. It's the only thing that's going to last forever, okay? Only the church will be the ultimate war against evil. And here's what Matthew's gospel says. Jesus said, I will build my church. Jesus said, I will build my church, and all the powers of hell will not prevail. And you think of all the things that the church has been through, the church of Jesus Christ, his church, all the things and all the wars and the world wars and all the stuff that's been going on since the beginning of time. And here we are in 2019 in a little village of Plymouth, and we are here gathered as God's people, the church. We're gathered here. We're gathered here. And you know what? Unless the Lord comes back soon, 100 years from now, there will still be gatherings of God's people in Plymouth, Ohio, even if it's not in this building, even if it's not in this venue. There's going to be a place where God's people will last forever. Okay, that's powerful. On the church is big enough to solve the global problem. Let me give you the scripture for that. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 20. By his mighty power at work within us, God is able to accomplish infinitely more than we would ever dare to ask or hope for. What is it? It's through his church. It's through the fact that he lived and died for the church. The church is a part of that which is a privilege to be a part of. You know, I never was one that really wanted to join a bunch of different organizations and be a part of this and part of that. And I've been asked to be a part of all some different clubs and associations, and I just haven't been one of those that they were able to depend on to do that. And so it just wasn't one of those priorities. But you know what? It's a privilege. It's a privilege to be a part of God's church. God has given us the privilege of being born again, that we may now be members of God's own family. See, here's the deal. Even though you are alive, until you're born in God's family, we're not a part of his church, okay? And you might even be here. I might even see you. You might see me and all that. But until we are born into God's family, we are not a part of God's family by association or status or wealth or creed or race. The only way that we're a part of God's family is through the blood of Jesus Christ. God gave his life for the church, and we can be born into his family by being made anew in Christ Jesus. So the privilege and the blessing of being a part of God's great church. Now, look at your sermon section, and we'll kind of close this out with, okay, so I hear what you're saying, and that's all very, very good, but what are the benefits of belonging to a church, okay? And now, I'm not talking about membership or partnership here today, okay? I'm just talking about how this, the body of Christ is bigger than membership or partnership ever will be, all right? You know, because it's way, way beyond that. So I think the question we have to ask ourselves from time to time is, well, what are the privileges and benefits? What is the benefit of being and belonging to a church family? And you know, don't get me. I mean, I could go on and on and on about this for a long, long time. I mean, just think of what has happened in your lifetime, or even in maybe the last 5 years or 10 years. And just think how the church was a part of your life. And it's just amazing. I mean, during time of loss, there's nothing in the world to compare to what I felt and sensed during a time of loss, to compare to what the church of Jesus Christ was able to do. Oh yeah, there's friends, there's associates, there's neighbors and whatever else, but it's the church, whether they were part of this church or the many, many other churches, because of God's church, all of those benefits that we receive during time of loss or crises or tragedy or even times of joy, you know. I mean, how many people like to share their joy with somebody else? I do. I like to brag on Jesus, and when something good happens, why not share? Why wait till something bad happens before we make the phone call? Have you ever made a phone call just because something good was going on? Hey, I just want to call and say, hey, how you doing? Hope you're having a great day. Oh, you know, good things are happening in my life, and I know good things are going to be happening in your life. Well, what'd you call for? Hey, I just called to let you know, hey, God is good. Life is not fair, but God's good, and I'm a happy camper today. Hope you have a great day. Again, we don't do that very often, do we? But when something bad happens, we want to make a phone call, or we want to tell somebody about it. And we should do that too, because you know what? That's part of being a part of God's church, and that's why we can be embracing each other. So let me just give you four or five benefits, okay, of belonging to a church family. First of all, belonging to a church family, it will help you and it will help me to focus on God. You might say, really? But then, as you think about it, you're going to say, you know what? That's kind of true. I really got busy this week, and yeah, I said my prayers and read my Bible. Boy, I tell you, I really, really got busy. But I tell you what, when we came to church as a body of believers, you know what? It was the church that helped me focus on God. Or maybe you weren't even in the building, but somebody called you from God's church, or somebody engaged with you, or maybe you were in a small group or Bible study or whatever. What was it? It was that which helped you to focus on God in the midst of all the stuff that's going on in your lives. And there's a lot of stuff going on, isn't there, huh? In your world, in my world, and there's always something to do, and there's always a place to be, and there's always something waiting for us to do that we haven't got done yet. That's part of our American way. But I think the benefits of belonging to a church family, it will help us to focus on God. Number two, it will help me to face life's problems. Okay? It will help me to face life's problems. And we all know that in life, there are problems. There's absolutely no way we can deny it. There's no way that we can even try to hide it. You know, we can, but life has problems. If you would be together in a small group of 6, 8, or 10 people, in that group, I don't care what age group it is. I don't care what age group it is. In the midst of that small group, there's going to be people that's going to express some of the problems that they're having in their life. You know what? Do you run down to the grocery store and talk to the owner or about your problems? Probably not. Do you go down to the police station? Well, you might go to the police station and talk to the problem. Depending on how big they are. If they're that big, that's okay. You know, we're kind of hooked up with them too, so I'm sure they can help. What is it? God has his church, and that is one way we can focus on God, and also we can face life's problems. Okay? It will help you to be fortify my faith. To fortify your faith with me is simply meaning this. It will help me to be strengthened. It will help me to have some strength and some help and some aid. And boy, I tell you what, there's times that you just might need a pickup, right? You just might need somebody just maybe the smile, maybe the hug, or maybe just the quick phone call or a quick text or maybe a note in the mail or whatever. You know, there's something about the Church of Jesus Christ. And, you know, that's where we get our strength. Okay? It will help me to fortify my faith, okay? It will help me to find my place and make a difference. That's part of our mission. That's part of our ministry here at LifePoint. When people come through the pastor's class or LifePoint 101 or whatever, you know, we want them to know. We don't want anybody to come in for a long length of time and not know what our purpose is, or not know what they can maybe do in serving or being a part of the purpose that we have here at LifePoint. So it's through the church that we helps us to find our purpose. I have people all the time that come up to me, and there are people that maybe you were from another church, or maybe you were not even from a church at all until you started attending here. And then what was it? It's been LifePoint Church, God's church, that helped you to find maybe what your purpose is in life. Okay? And then number five, it will help me fulfill my life's mission. Let me just say this. There's a life mission that God has for you. And the life mission that God has for you can be different than anybody else's life mission. Matter of fact, it probably needs to be, all right? I mean, it might be the same as somebody else down the road. But the point of it is, you know, it's not my life's mission that you need. You need your life's mission. And there's something about the church with God's Spirit moving and God's power, and with hopefully the leadership and the opportunities that we announce and that we display. Hopefully, those are some of the reasons, some of the things that will help you find out what your life's mission is. For some, just for example, I mean, I have many illustrations I could give. But let me just give a couple here this morning. There are people at LifePoint Church that for you to provide a meal for somebody going through a sick time, or for somebody that maybe has lost a loved one, and you stand over your stove and you bake that pie and you fix that fried chicken and those mashed potatoes and gravy and the green beans and the freezer corn and the garden ripe tomatoes. Are we doing okay so far? I think the video said, forget about the food, did it? Okay, I'm sorry, Lord, okay. What is it? That is part of your life's mission in God's church. Because I'm not going to be the person that's going to be doing that. And maybe many, many dozens of other people, that's not going to be their mission for doing that. But it's going to be your mission. And you're going to do it within God's church. And it's going to be maybe to somebody that doesn't even attend church. Maybe somebody in the community or your neighbor or somebody that you don't even know. And maybe God just impresses upon you to do something regarding that. I believe one of the biggest reasons why that will take place is because the church has helped you find and fulfill your life's mission. So I just want to kind of give a little bit of an overview this morning and just kind of talk to you from my heart, because I really, really believe that as we think of LifePoint Church, some of the things that we've done, it's not about our building. It's not about, you know, necessarily the color of the carpet or the chairs or all those kind of things. All those things are important, but those are the side notes. Those are just the side notes as to what we do to really accomplish the purpose that God has for us. And I know this, when I drive up and down these streets in Plymouth, and I come over here to this little rig street, and here we are sitting a little bit back off the road. You know, we have great accessibility. We don't have the greatest visibility. And I tell people, it's just one turn and you can sit, okay? It's one turn from the main drag, all right? Whichever one you're on. But as I think about all of that, I said, you know what? There has to be a reason why we're here. There has to be a purpose. And we were talking about this a little bit last night. And you know what? We want it all to be, all of the honor and the glory go to God. But we want to be the church. We want to be the people of the church, obviously. I'm not talking about this morning. When people think about you, and then they ask you, where do you attend church? Where's your church building at? And you begin to tell them, it's way, way, way better. The right thing is for them to have a good word than a bad word. You know, last night it was way more pleasant that the fellow, I didn't even know his name, was giving me some good things that he had heard about Light Point. Firstly, for him to say, you know what, can I tell you 10 reasons why I would never attend your church? That might have put me in bed. I might have not even been here this morning. So what am I saying? We are the church. When you walk through the grocery store, when you walk down the sidewalk, when you go to work, when you open the door for the person at the post office, you are the church of Jesus Christ. And that's beautiful. It's beautiful. Have you ever been in a room that I'm done? Have you ever been in a room and maybe you're in a room full of people and you only know maybe three or four? But over here in the corner is this couple, and they're in a, and after you got talking to them, there's just something different about them. You said, man, I tell you what, I know I went to this, it was like a social function. It wasn't a church function, it wasn't a religious function, but it was this deal I went to, but boy, this one couple, this one person, there is something that was different around them. And then you maybe strike up a conversation, maybe then or even sometime later, and bingo, what happened? You found out that they were a Christ follower. And you kind of knew it all along. What was it? They were being the church. And you're being the church. Okay? Every conversation, oh. One more thing, and this won't even cost you any extra, I promise. And we're going to have the offering at the end. We should even be the church on Facebook. Yeah. Isn't that a great thought? Why would you put anything on Facebook that would just get even a teeny negative wrong slant to Christ or His church? Folks, that was completely free.